Last time, starting with a family of groups, we took the disjoint union of these groups as our alphabets. Over these alphabets, we constructed what are known as free words, which are nothing but finite sequences of alphabets. On the free words, we introduced an equivalence relation, right? And that made it into a group. Namely, concatenation of two sequences, two words, gives you a free word. Along with the empty word, it makes it a semi-group, associative binary operation with a two-sided identity. All right, but it is not a group. To make it a group, we took equivalence classes of these. Namely, equivalence relation was defined by a chain of elementary collapsing or its inverse. Finite chain of such a thing. If two words are related, then they are said to be equivalent. So that equivalence classes were denoted by bracket W. These equivalence classes becomes a group under the obvious inverse operation, namely take a sequence x1 x2 xn, take inverse formally as inverses of each xi written in the opposite order. These inverses make sense because they are elements of various groups that we have taken. This on the right hand side, these inverses are genuine inverses of group elements. On the left hand side, this inverse is a notation. Now we can verify that when you go to the classes, equivalence classes, that SS inverse is equivalent to empty set. Therefore, on the classes, this is the inverse. So this much we had seen. So today we shall complete the proof of the existence by showing that this bracket W is the one which satisfies the required properties, namely the universal property. Okay. So we introduce a terminology here. A free word is called a reduced word if either it is empty word is a reduced word, or the following conditions hold. None of the entries of this free word should be an identity in any of these groups. That is the first condition. The second condition is no two consecutive elements should belong to the same group. Remember, under these two conditions, we can collapse. Whenever such a condition is there, whenever any element is identity element, we delete it. So that is for the first collapsing. Whenever two elements are consecutive and belong to the same group, again we collapse by writing them together as one single element in the corresponding group. Therefore, these two operations, if performed finitely many times, any given word will be equivalent to a reduced word. After all, you start with a finite sequence. So in finitely many words, all these things is possible, because each time you perform this, the length is reduced. Okay, therefore, what we have just observed is that in the equivalence class of free words, there is always a reduced word. Okay, there is always a reduced word. I mean, it may be empty also. Empty word is by definition reduced. Okay, so the point is, if there is always a reduced word, if I say that is weaker than saying that every free word in finitely many steps can be reduced to a reduced word, can be collapsed to a reduced word. Actually, collapse in nothing else, one single way. Of course, collapsing, that is equivalence class. Okay. What is not clear is that suppose you have a very huge word, collapsing can take place in different ways and different directions, okay, different order, then it is not at all clear that you will get the same two people if they start working, or two different people or two different kind of algorithms are written down, whether you will get the same reduced word. Whether there may be two different reduced words representing the same class. But this is not clear. Okay? So, what is fundamental importance to us is that the equivalence class of every word contains a unique reduced word. So this is what we want to see. And this is more or less key to the universal property of this the group that you have constructed. Okay, they go simultaneously. Okay, so let us study this one carefully. So here is a technically superior method. This method should be learned. It can be useful elsewhere also. Okay, it's actually used in linear algebra quite often. Linear algebra of functional analysis, exterior algebra, and so on. So what we do is, we shall denote the set W hat, subset of W hat, consisting of all reduced words by removing that hat. So that's reduced words. This is a subset. Actually, it is there, each element there in each equivalence class is below, namely square W. So W surjects on to square W. Okay. So what we would like to say is this square W, the equivalence class, is in a bijection with W. Okay. So for seeing this one, what we do is, take the permutation group of W. W is now reduced words, not the whole of W hat. The permutation group is a very huge group, of course. That is the key. Okay. Let this PW denote the group of all permutations of W. Fix a group one of the GIs, concentrate on one of the GIs. We shall define a subgroup LGI of this PW, okay, and I will denote for each G belong to GI fixed, each G belongs to G, corresponding LG. These are the elements of PW. So that will be a correspondence between G going to LG, that is going to be a monomorphism. Under that, we can get a group LGI, okay, a subgroup of LGI, which is isomorphic to GI. This is the first, starting point of this universal property, starting proof. Okay, so if G is identity, take LG to be identity. Because after all, you want it to have a group homomorphism. Okay, identity of what? Identity. Endomorphism, identity, permutation of W. To each G which is not identity, let LG be defined as follows. So we have to have patience, because we want to take a reduced word to a reduced word. If you have to define it on W hat, that was very obvious. But here, we want to take reduced word to reduced word. By the very notation, LG is going to be left multiplication in some sense. So what we are going to do, we are going to do a left multiplication on W, but then we have to do reduction also, reduce word. So G is a non-trivial element, okay? Then LG of S, where S is a reduced word, will be defined as follows. If S is empty, LG is just the sequence little g, that namely one single element. Okay. If S is, let us say, one single element, S1, okay, the first one, only one element, and K is equal to 1. So S is a singleton sequence, S1, but this S1 is G inverse. Then when you multiply by G, it won't be reduced, right? So you combine them, GG inverse identity, just check it out. What you get is empty set, empty word. So LG of S, namely LG of G inverse, which defined to be empty word. Next, suppose it is not, K is bigger than 1. Then all that you have to do is, S1 is G inverse, so you cut it out. Write it as S2 up to SK. Remember, this is S1, S2, SK was a reduced word. If you cut it short at one part, okay, either initial part or end part, it will be still reduced. If you cut out somewhere middle, then it may not be. Okay. So I have dropped out S1 here. This is still a reduced word. Okay, take this as definition. Now, up to these three cases are over. The next case is, S1 is not an element of G1 at all. Then just put the G extra. So S1, S2, SK as it is, G will come on the left. So this is L of S1, S2, SK, L of SC, LG of S is this one. Okay, if S1 is not in GI at all. The last condition is, suppose S1 is in GI, but it is not the inverse of G. Then you just combine G and S1. G, S1 is not identity. So this itself is a reduced word. Okay, so that completes the definition of what is the meaning of LG of S. LG, take a reduced word. I have produced another reduced word. Therefore, LG for each G is a function from W to W. We have to show that it's a bijection. Then only it is a permutation, right? So when ED checks that, LG of W is contained inside W. Contained inside W means what? W is a reduced word, is also. LG of W is also a reduced word. Okay. The bijection part is taken care of very easily by just checking that LG inverse composite to LG is identity. Similarly, LG composite to LG inverse. Okay. LG inverse LG, go through this definition at each step. You get back the original sequence S here. So this is actually an element of PW. It's also clear that if LG equal to LH, then G must be equal to H, because you operate it on, these are two permutations, right? Operate it on empty set. Empty set is a reduced word. LG of empty set by definition is the singleton G. LG, LH is also singleton H, right? Therefore, singleton G equal to singleton H, therefore G equal to H. Therefore, this L is what is injective. Okay. So simply taking value L on an empty set. Finally, we need to verify that L is a homomorphism. See, L itself is injective. Each LG is a permutation. Okay, that's different than saying L is injective. L itself is injective. And now I have to verify that L is a homomorphism. Okay, that is L of GH equal to LG composite LH, or G and H belong to GI. This is also easy, but you have to have patience and verify everything properly. Okay, so in order to show this, what you have to show, Lg of a reduced over S is equal to Lg of Lh of S. Okay, so what I want to say is, suppose S is of length more than 1, then this will follow by just, suppose first I have proved it for length 1 elements. Suppose this formula is true for length 1 elements. Then for any element of length more than 1, the S2 to Sk part, remember, is never disturbed in the definition. So you have to just put back those S2 to Sk part after getting the formula for k equal to 1. All right. Therefore, you have to verify it only for length 1 elements. Okay. So LgH of S equal to Lg composite Lh of S is what you have to verify. And this is very easy. Again, you have to go through this list. Okay, for example, suppose first case, namely S is empty, that's also length, it's actually length 0, then it's very clear. Lg of what? Lg, Lh of empty set is Lg of operating one H. G and H are in the same group. So Lg of that one is Lgh. So Lgh operating upon empty set is also Gh. So like that, you can verify the entire thing is, it's verified for element 1. So what we have done so far is, for each I, Gi to permutation of W's, that is a monomorphism given by, for each Gi, left multiplication by Gi. It's a monomorphism. So I can identify Gi with this subgroup L of Gi inside PW. Okay? So this I can do for all I, all right? So therefore, I should need a different notation. I will call them as Li. So this was earlier, I had just L because I had fixed Gi. So let us call these as Li, okay? Now what you have is, it is not necessary because they are different, L is by Li. Now what you have, what is union of all LGIs, they are subgroups, each of them is subgroup. They will generate a subgroup. Okay, union is not a subgroup. The union will generate a subgroup. Okay, that subgroup is isomorphic to this bracket W is what we want to show. So let us have notation. This is final notation. Union of all GIs generates a subgroup of PW, and let us take that as G. Okay, so our definition of G is this one. Now what we are going to show is that this subgroup of PW is actually isomorphic to this bracket W, the equivalence classes of three words, and we are also going to show that it is biject corresponds to a set of reduced words. So various ways of looking at this group that will help to consolidate the entire thing. All right. So this bracket W, we know it's a group. Ordinary W, reduced words, we don't know whether it is a group. Okay. But each, there is at least each equivalence class, there is a reduced word here. We want to show that all these are isomorphic to each other. There is a group structure here. There's a group structure G here. You want to say these two are equivalent. It's the same isomorphic. Okay. So how do you proceed? Start with a free word S inside W hat. That is an element of W hat. Okay. Now you define a map, a function from this W hat into PW. What is that? In fact, we will define a map inside G, which will land in G. What is that? Look at S1, S2, S3. S1 will be in some Li, Li1, Li2, and so on. Sorry, in Gi1, Gi2, and so on. Accordingly, you take those homomorphism, monomorphism, Li1, Li2, and so on. Take Li1, S1, Lik, Sk, compose them in the same order, S1, S2, Sk, in the same order. These are all permutations of W. Remember that. Okay. So we compose them. But they are all inside the union of all Lig. Therefore, this element is inside capital G, the subgroup generated by this thing. So what we have got is for each element W hat, we have got an element of G. So that is a function. Okay. This function is clearly a homomorphism of semigroup into a group. Right? How do you compose here? S1, S2, Sk, and then Sk plus 1, etc. The next one, next sequence. The same way you are composing here also. So this is a homomorphism of semigroups. Okay? Of course, the codomain is a group, but it's homomorphism of semigroups. One more thing you can say that, suppose S collapses to S prime, just simple elementary collapsing, then psi S will be equal to psi S prime. Why? There are two cases when this collapses. One of the SIs here may be identity. Then Lij whatever of Sj whatever you are taking there, that will be identity. So the two compositions will be the same. Next, suppose two of them, say S1 and S2, are consecutive things which are in the same group. Then I am taking S1, S2. Then, but here I will get the same Li, Li of S1 and Li of S2. But Li itself is a homomorphism. So Li of S1 into Li of S2 is Li of S1, S2. Therefore, and under elementary collapsing, the values of psi s and psi s prime are the same. What does this mean? This means that this psi map actually factors down to give you a map psi bar from equivalence classes of W to G. This map is going to be an isomorphism. Okay, let us see how. So given an element is G, by definition, what is G? G is finite combinations, finite sequence of elements, product of elements Gi belonging to Gi, actually of Lgis. So G is actually Lg1, L1, G1, Lk, Gk, where I assume Gi's are inside corresponding Gi's. This is just a free notation. I should, strictly speaking, I should write Li1, G1, Li2, G2, Lik, Gk. Every element looks like that. Okay. Take S to be just this G1, G2, Gk belonging to W hat. This is a free word. Okay. Then psi of S will be clearly this one by very definition, which implies psi bar of S, when you go down in the class, it's also G. The psi bar is induced by psi. What we have shown just now is that psi bar is surjective because psi itself is surjective. Now we want to show that this is injective. Psi bar of S, remember this is already homomorphism. So psi bar of S equal to psi bar of S prime, you must show that S must be equal to S prime. Not S equal to S prime, but the classes. So this is where you have to go to the classes. S may not be equal to S prime, but their equivalence classes, they are the same. So all that you have to do, pick up reduced words which represent them. We have seen that in each class there is a reduced word. Take the reduced word representing them. Okay, then psi s is equal to psi s prime, because when you go down, this is the equation that I have. Therefore, what is the psi s of empty word? It must be equal to psi s prime on the empty word, because these are endomorphisms. If they are equal, their value on the empty word must be the same. But by definition, what is psi s of this one, empty word? Okay. Suppose for any reduced S, S1 to Sk, we have psi, because I have chosen S and S prime, reduced words, psi S of this one, okay, empty set, it will be just S1, S2, Sk. Right? Remember, what is it? It is L, last Lik of Sk, acting on empty word. That will produce Sk. The next one is Lik k minus 1 acting upon sk minus 1. But sk minus 1 and sk cannot cancel out, neither they are trivial elements. Therefore, when you multiply this one, it will become again sk minus 1 into sk. Inductively, like this, you will get s1 s2 sk. Okay, the sequence s1 s2 sk. Therefore, on s prime also, you will get s1 s2 s1 plus sk prime. If these two are equal, s must be equal to s prime. You can directly do this by saying that suppose psi s prime is identity, then show that s is collapsible. If s is a reduced word, not identity, it cannot be identity. That's what you can directly show that also. Okay, there are different ways of putting this one. Idea is the same. What we have done so far is that psi bar is an isomorphism from the equivalence classes of words, free words, to this group, which is a subgroup of the permutation groups of reduced words. Already, we have already a hidden thing here, namely in this proof, I wrote down this one not for fun. This already tells you that in each equivalence class, there is only one reduced word. Can you see that? This tells you that the two reduced words, if they are in the same equivalence class, then they must be equal. So let us run through that proof again, because this is so important. Okay. Suppose S and S prime are two reduced words in the same equivalence class. That is, I am assuming S equal to S prime. Then S, which is psi S of empty, this much what we have seen. Because S is reduced, psi S of empty word is just S. But by definition, this is psi bar of S operating on empty word. If psi bar of S equal to psi bar of S prime, because the classes are the same. If psi bar is well defined, that's what we have seen. But psi bar S prime of empty set is psi S prime of this one, because S prime is reduced. But this is equal to S prime. Okay, therefore, in each equivalence class, there is only one reduced word. There is exactly one reduced word. From that, if you take psi bar, it will become a bijection onto the group G. Reduced words themselves, defining a group operation, was a bit awkward. We have avoided that. Now you can pull back the definition of group structure on G onto reduced words. Finally, if you want to just work with reduced words, what you have to do? Take a reduced word, take another reduced word, put one after the other. It may not be reduced, but keep collapsing. You will go to a unique reduced word. That is the definition of the composition law on reduced words. You see why we needed to have unique reduced words. Otherwise, definition of, you know, alpha composite beta doesn't make sense. Even after this, proving associativity is a hell of a problem. We avoided all this, okay, cleverly by going to the permutation group of all reduced words. Okay, also we have shown that there are monomorphisms from each GI to this W now. Okay, this W is reduced word which is in bijection with G. So I can replace this W by G if you want. So these eta I's along with this G, this is going to be our pre-product. So we have to verify the universal property. Okay? Okay. Given any homomorphism Fi from GI to H, a sequence of homomorphisms, we define F from W hat, namely free words, to H by the formula F of S1 S2 Sk equal to Fi1 of S1, Fik of Sk. Just take the corresponding Fi's and their compositions in the correct same order, where Sj's are in Gij's. This Ij's, which Fi I have to take, depends upon where S1 is, where S2 is, where S3 is, and so on. Take this product. There is no ambiguity in the free word defining anything. There is no ambiguity. Okay. Verify that this is a homomorphism, just like in the case of our L, this is a homomorphism is also obvious. Homomorphism of what? Of the semigroup into H. Okay. The next thing is, just like we have done for LIs, verify that it takes same values on equivalence classes. Namely, if S reduces to S prime, if S is collapses to S prime, we have to just verify. Then the value of F is the same. This is also again the same way, the way we have done it for LI, because if S1 is identity, then this is really, this can be checked out. If S1 and S2 are the same element, then Fi1, Fi2 are the same. Fi1 of S1 composite S2 equal to Fi1 of S1 into Fi of S2, because Fi's are homomorphisms. The same argument. Therefore, there is a well-defined homomorphism F from what is this W? These are now reduced words, but they are equivalence classes. That's a better way of thinking. You think of them as equivalence classes, because one W is representing the whole equivalence class, and that is a uniqueness. That's why I can put it as W. Okay, so there is a well-defined map from W to H. Okay, which clearly has the property that if you take eta I of G, eta is how it's defined. Eta I of G is just singleton G. That is a reduced word. Okay. So this Fi operating upon this is precisely that if this sequence is a singleton one, then wherever it is that coming from Gi, it is Fi of that. So eta F composite eta I is Fi of G. Okay. For every G inside Gi. So it satisfies these conditions. Only thing is, why F is unique? F is already agreeing on all GIs, and GIs generate the capital G. If you have homomorphism, okay, of a group, it is completely determined once you know its values on a set of generators. Therefore, F is unique. So this completes the proof of that this eta I comma G, G comma eta I, this family is the free product of the family GI. Okay, so we have this notation for free product. GIs are families of groups on a indexing set lambda, then you can have this one. So we summarize this one, whatever you have done, namely start with a collection of groups. Then the set W of all reduced words in the union of this GI. Now for reduced words, you can chuck away the identity. There is no identity, doesn't play any role. You have to cut it anyway, right? Whenever. So take just reduced words in these letters. Of course, reduction you have to still do. The disjointing of this one. This forms a pre-product, product of GI. Under the usual law of composition, concatenation and reduction. Just concatenate, it won't give you reduced words. So we have not directly proved this, we have proved it indirectly. Okay. Yeah. We have verified that this definition is the same as the other definition. But we have not verified that this definition is associative, left multiplication, left identity, right identity, those things we have avoided. Now here is an easy, if you have understood this construction and so on, easy, result which is very useful. Namely, suppose you have a sequence of or a collection of homomorphism from GI to HI. Form the free product here, form the free product here. Then all these alpha i's will extend to a single map alpha homomorphism from the free product of all these first family of subgroups, the free product of all these HIs. In such a way that on subgroups alpha i's, the GIs, they are equal, it is equal to alpha i. That means alpha is an extension of all these things. Remember, GIs and HIs are subgroups here. Okay. If you follow this construction, then this is obvious. All that you have to do is look at the free words and define there it's obvious. Then all that you have to do is keep reduction process. That's all. Okay. So let us do all other constructions, like we have to pushouts and various things. We have just done one single memory construction of free product. That we will do next time. Thank you.